Good evening and welcome on board. We are going to take a flight this evening, which will take approximately 45 minutes. On this flight, the Holy Spirit will be the pilot, known as the guide in Scripture. The fuel of this plane is going to be faith. Our control tower is God. I'm just the voice on the plane. You can forget about me, but remember the words that proceed forth from my mouth. And our destination is at Jesus' feet. In order for us to land safely at Jesus' feet, I need you to put your cell phones on flight mode so that we do not experience any turbulence. You have 5 seconds to do that. I'm so excited. I want to get right into the message. 5 seconds to put your cell phones on flight mode, or 10. And we are ready for takeoff. Let us bow our heads as we seek the Lord. Father in heaven, have mercy upon me. And Father, please have mercy upon those who are about to listen to your word. I pray that every demon may be bound in Jesus' name. And I pray that you may be glorified. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. The title of the sermon is Home Controversy. And this is part one of the home controversy. Revival does not begin in church. Revival begins at home. If you have your Bibles, or if you don't, I invite you to Genesis chapter 1, verse 24. Now, God created the world in 6 days. And the Bible says, and God saw that it was good, meaning what God created was perfect. It was how he intended it to be forever and ever. And in Genesis chapter 2 verse 5, the Bible says, and there was not a man to till the ground, meaning after God created everything, the animals, the sea, the stars, the moon, everything, and earth, that there was no one to till the ground. Genesis 1:26 says, and God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion upon the earth. This is the verse that I call, let us, let them. God was not alone during creation. It says, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion upon the earth. John chapter 1 says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And it says that the Word became flesh, and that he was rejected by this world. Jesus Christ was present during creation. And it's in Philippians and Colossians that also talks about Jesus taking part in creation. It says that in him, through him, and for him were all things created. So God created the world in 6 days. Everything was perfect, spotless, it was blameless, and it was the way God intended it to be. And after he created it, he handed it over to man. If you come with me, in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7 to 8, the Bible says, and the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. This is talking about the creation of Adam. Adam was created before Eve. And if you go on to Genesis 2:15, the Bible says, and the Lord God took the man and put him into the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. So after God created the world, God created Adam. Adam was the first to be created. And we'll look at that as we go on. And then Eve came later on. But after God created the world, he created Adam, and he put Adam in the garden to dress it and to keep it. In other words, to manage the garden. He gave him authority over the garden. He was the manager of the garden. If you proceed in Genesis chapter 2 verse 16, it says, and the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, of every tree, but In Genesis 2:17, God says, except for that tree in the center, it says in this verse, thou shalt not eat of it. Thou shalt surely die. You must not eat from the tree that is in the center of the garden. This was God speaking to Adam. Eve was not around. Proof of that is in verse 18, where the Bible says, and the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. It is not good. I will make him a helpmeet for him. Now, this does not mean that God created Adam and then realized that he made a mistake and said, oh, Adam is alone. He's lonely. No. God is revealing to us that we were not created to live alone. He is revealing to us that women are also important. And Adam could not till the ground. He could not keep the garden without a helpmeet. But the Bible says that God said, I will make him a helpmeet for him. In other version, it does not say a helpmeet, but it says, I will make him a compatible helper. So the person that God was planning to create for Adam was no ordinary person. It was somebody who was to be compatible with him. Spirit of Prophecy, Patriot and Prophet, says this, even communion with angels could not have satisfied, this is Adam, his desire for sympathy and companionship. There was none of the same nature to love and to be loved. Adam used to enjoy the companionship of the angels. He used to commune with the angels. But that was not enough. My dear friends, if you do not have the gift of celibacy, do not attempt to live alone. Even Adam, in his perfect state in heaven, he needed someone of the same nature. And so God created not an ordinary helper, but a compatible helpmeet for Adam. And you imagine, Eden was perfect. It was beautiful. But even in that environment, he needed someone with the same nature. He needed a fellow human being to be with him. If you come to Genesis 2:19, the Bible says, and to 2:20, and Adam gave what? Names. And there was not found a helpmeet for him. When God created Adam, God gave Adam authority and the privilege of naming the animals. And whatever name Adam gave to the animals, that was its name. When he saw the tiger, well, he said, you will be the tiger, you will be the leopard, you will be the elephant, and whatever name he gave, that was its name. Again, you see God here giving authority to Adam, and it was Adam who was leading out. This was before Eve came. Again, God says that there was not found an helpmeet for him. This is repeated. This is in verse 19. Now, when you come with me to Genesis 2:21, the Bible says, and the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon who? Upon Adam. And he slept. And he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And here you have the first operation. If you come with me to Genesis 2:21, the Bible says, and the Lord God caused a deep sleep. That's what you call anesthesia. To fall upon Adam, and he slept. And the Lord God took one of his rib and closed. Now, you can only close something that has been opened. So God caused the deep sleep to fall upon Adam. And then God opened and God removed one of his ribs. And then God closed it. There you have the first operation recorded in the Bible. And it is done by God. Now, what is God going to do with that rib? Come with me to Genesis 2, verse 22. The Bible says, and the rib which the Lord God had taken from who? From man, made he a woman and brought her unto the man. So the woman came from the man, from the rib of the man. You come with me to Genesis 2:23, the following verse. The Bible says this, after God created Eve out of the rib of Adam, God took Eve and brought Eve and gave Eve to Adam. And Adam held Eve in his arms and he looked at her and he said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man." Woman means out of man. Adam not only named the animals, but Adam also named her. He said she will be called what? Woman. Or he called a woman because she was taken out of man. Genesis chapter 2, 24, the Bible says, "Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife. They shall be one flesh." So the man must leave and the man must cleave. This is now marriage. This is the first wedding being recorded in the Bible. It says that the man must leave and that the man must cleave. But today people are cleaving and then people are leaving. If you come with me to Genesis 2:24, God says, or the Bible says, that the man must cleave, I must leave and cleave. But today people are cleaving and then people are leaving to get married. Instead of dating and then getting married, people do things that married people are supposed to do, and then they want to date in marriage. The first wedding is recorded. But come with me to Genesis 1:27. The Bible says that God made what? Male and female created he them. God created male and what? And female. In Genesis 1:28, which is the following verse, just after verse 27, it says this, "And God blessed them." This is male and female. "And God said, be fruitful and multiply, replenish." Now you see the words I've highlighted in green. They're almost the same words. Be fruitful, multiply, and replenish. The blessing to this newlywed couple was that God blessed them and told them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish. And then it says, subdue the earth, have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over everything that moveth upon the earth. Here you have recorded the first wedding in the Bible. And it was between a male and a what? And a female. Come with me to Genesis 2:27. What does it say? Male and female created he them. And after he created them, if you look at that beautiful picture, that is a male and a female, and that is the first wedding recorded in the Bible. And verse 28 says that he blessed them and he told them, be fruitful and multiply. There's a reason why I'm repeating that the blessing, God said, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. Come with me now. This means that God only blesses a relationship of a male and female. Only a male and a female can reproduce. Only a male and a female can multiply. Only a male and a female can reproduce. Sex in marriage is a blessing from God. But when it is outside of marriage, it can become a curse. Homosexuality was not in God's plan. God created Adam and Eve, male and female, not Adam and Steve, not Adama and Eve, but Adam and Eve. And verse 27 says that God blessed them and he told them, be fruitful and multiply. My dear friends, a male and a male or a female and a female cannot multiply. God does not recognize that type of marriage. Come with me now. This reminds me of the story in Genesis chapter 6 and chapter 7. When God told Noah to build the ark, God gave strict instructions. Come with me, Genesis 7, verse 2. The Bible says, of every clean beast, male and his what? His female. Beasts not clean by two, and male and his what? And his female. There's an emphasis here. Verse 3. Of the fowls, they must also be male and what? And female. Why is this? God says to keep the seed alive upon the face of all the earth. Before I explain this, let's read the rest of the verses. Verse 9. There went in what? Two by two unto Noah into the ark, the male and the what? And the female. And God had what? Commanded Noah. Verse 15. And they went in unto Noah into the ark, two and two of all flesh. This means humans and animals. They went in two by two, male and female, of all flesh, wherein is the breath of life. Verse 16. And they that went in male and what? And female of all flesh, as God had what? Commanded him, and the Lord God shut him in. So when God told Noah to build the ark, God told him, preach. I'll give you 120 years, preach. People ignored him. And God told him, only male and female must come into the ark. And God commanded him, you must not have only males in the ark. You must not have only females in the ark, but you must have both male and female. They must come in two by two of all flesh, male and female. Why is this? I want to ask you a question. The Bible says that God commanded him. God commanded Noah to do this. Think with me. Imagine if Noah said, I will disobey the Lord. Instead of me allowing males and females in the ark of all flesh, as God has commanded, I will only allow males in the ark. I will only allow male animals in the ark. I will not allow female animals in the ark. Or imagine he said, I will only allow my daughters to enter the ark. No males in the ark. My sons will not enter the ark. Or if he said, I will only allow my sons to enter the ark. Only males, no females. What do you think would have happened? Well, I don't think we would have been here today unless if he allowed only males, maybe after the flood, if God would have created females, then probably we would have continued to exist. So God was about to destroy the world, and God said, because of the sins, and by the way, God is not pleased with the death of the wicked. When you see God destroying in the Bible, that's because it's now the only way. Those people have gone too far, and they decided not to come to God, and in order for them not to influence others, God has to destroy them, unfortunately, and he is not pleased at the death of the wicked. Now, my dear friends, imagine if Noah disobeyed God and only allowed males or only females in the ark. God says, fill the earth and multiply. This means God wants us to live and to reproduce. This is why he created male and female. This is why he told Noah to put in male and female in the ark. My dear friends, homosexuality is not to multiply, it is to multi-die. And that equals death. And did you know that HIV, it is highly spread by them, even in the States. And it comes with many diseases. Now, when we disobey God, we suffer. I do not have time to explain this to you, but homosexuality will bring disease into this world. Homosexuality is not to multiply. It is to multi-die. God gives life. The devil is the one who gives death. Homosexuality is not from God. And you see today, just Friday last week, in the US, they've legalized same-sex marriage in every state, and this will spread throughout the world. If you look at this picture, now, instead of Adam and Eve, we have Adams and Steve. This is unfortunate. This is sad. I am not condemning. I have a solution, and the solution is Jesus Christ. But this is serious. Jesus said, as it was in the days of Lot, so shall it be before I come. In the days of Lot, in Sodom and Gomorrah, same-sex marriage was legal. And my dear friends, we are living in such a time. Not only do we have today Adam and Steve instead of Adam and Eve, but we even have, instead of Adam and Eve, we have Adama and Eve. This is unfortunate. This is unfortunate. Now, after God created Adam and Eve, male and female, God gave them dominion and they were to rule the garden together. Look at this with me. Adam was the male. Eve was the female. Adam was the prince and the manager of the garden and of the world. He was actually the prince of the world. Eve was the princess and the counselor of Adam. She was to support Adam and help him in keeping the garden. Adam was created first, as we saw in Genesis. Adam created from pure dust. Eve came from his rib. Adam was created to tend the garden. Adam named the animals and Adam named Eve. Or I think I need to change it, but when Eve was created, he called her woman because she was taken from his rib, and Adam was the head. He was in charge and she was supporting him. Eve was created second, and Eve was taken out of man, created from his rib. Eve was created as a suitable helper, as we saw in the Bible. It was not good for man to be alone. Let me make him a suitable or a compatible helper. Come with me now. Eve was named by Adam, or let me say he called her woman because she was taken out of him. And the animals were named also by him. Eve is the neck. Adam is the head, but Eve is the neck that helps or makes the head move. So both of them need each other. Adam was created to be the prince and manager of earth. Eve was to be the princess and the counselor, and the devil seeks to destroy this. But did you know this? Spirit of Prophecy, Adventist Home, chapter 25, page 25, paragraph 1 says this: God prepared man's first what? First home. The Eden home of our first parents was prepared for them by God himself. This means that Eden was a home. It goes on to say, when he had furnished it with everything that man could desire, he said, "Let us make man in our image after our likeness." So after God created the world, God furnished it for Adam and Eve. It was supposed to be their home. God was designing a home for them. So the Garden of Eden was a home. And still she says in same, this is now Patriots and Prophet, page 41, paragraph 1. She says, the Creator gave them still another token of his love by preparing a garden especially for their home. So the Garden of Eden was the first home for man, for Adam and Eve. God created a home, and he created Adam, and he created Eve, male and female, and God placed them in the garden, which was their home, and they were to till it together and to take care of that home. Adventist Home, page 21, paragraph 1 says, the presence of Christ alone can make man and woman happy. All the common waters of life, Christ can turn into the wine of heaven. The home then becomes as an Eden of bliss. The family, a beautiful symbol of the family in heaven. So this home, the Garden of Eden, was a beautiful home. It was a peaceful home. It was a quiet home. It was a blessed home because Jesus Christ was the center of that home. This means that only a Christ-centered home is a happy home. Any home that does not have Christ is not a happy home. Now, this home was a happy home because Christ was the center of it. But something happened in that home. The intruder appeared in that home. And once he came, this is the intruder. His name is the devil, Lucifer, Satan, the serpent. And he came into this home, this happy home, and he introduced self, pride, into this home. Now let's look at the background of this intruder. He began in heaven, Lucifer, son of the morning star. Isaiah 14 verse 12 says, "How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? I will," verse 13, "ascend into heaven." This is Lucifer speaking. "I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above. I will be like the Most High." Lucifer fell because of pride. And today we are in this mess because of pride. The church is being divided today, unfortunately, because of pride. Lucifer said he wanted to be more than God. And verse 14 of Isaiah, he says, "I will be like the Most High." He not only kept this idea to himself, but he went on spreading to the other angels and convinced one third of the angels that God is not fair and God does not care. God is not ruling right. We don't need the Ten Commandments. And by the way, the devil is doing the same thing today, using people who are powerful in this world that are trying to put God's commandment aside, abandoning the word of God. This is why you have countries like the US legalizing same-sex marriage, departing from the word. He says that God is not fair. We don't need God. We don't need his laws. We don't need his ways. He's not fair. And God does not care. Now, he said he wanted to be like God. My dear friends, he went to Eve. And by the way, we have studied that the Garden of Eden was a home. So he intruded in their home and he told Eve, "Ye shall be as what? As gods." In other words, you will be like God if you eat this fruit. Remember, the devil said, "I will ascend and I will be like God." It was this pride, it was pride that made him fall. He wanted to be like God. So he comes to the home of Adam and Eve. And he tells Eve, "If you eat it, you shall be like what? Like God." The same evil desire that led to his fall. He comes to the home of Adam and Eve and he introduces this same selfish idea to be like God to Eve. And Eve, unfortunately, accepts it. And here begins the home controversy, the fight between the forces of good and evil. When the devil is now intruding into the home that God has created for Adam and Eve. Now, Genesis 3 verse 6 says, "And the woman saw that the fruit was good to eat and pleasant to the eyes. She did eat and gave also unto her," what? "Her husband with her, and he did eat." There are many things we can learn from this text. First thing, it does not say that Eve was hungry. She saw and it looked pleasant to the eye. So she did not eat because she was hungry. There are three things here I want to highlight. The Bible's, first of all, before she saw it, she listened to the devil. The devil told her, "Come, you will be like God." They entered into a conversation. My dear friends, do not entertain the devil. Flee from the devil. But if you look carefully, she listened to him. And what did she listen to? She listened to lies. And my dear friends, the devil is doing the same thing today. He is entering many homes and he's destroying those homes with lies and gossip, telling false things, saying that God does not care, that God, it does not answer your prayers. God does not care about you. God has abandoned you. He brings in gossip and sets family members against one another, just as he did in the Garden of Eden, turning Eve against God, telling her, "You will be like God. You will be wise. Don't you want to be like God? God is restraining you from being what you really have to be, from being the best that you can be." Second thing, the Bible says she saw. And the devil does the same thing today. He attacks the home through bad example and through TV. Today, all you see in TV is corruption. It is crime. It is death. It is war. It is spiritual adultery. You have fornication. You have so many things that are influencing children today to grow up in an ungodly manner. They grow up without a desire to have a relationship with Christ. From movies to music that we watch today on TV. Not only did she see, but the Bible says she tasted. And many homes are destroyed through alcohol, through smoking, through premarital sex, and etc. Many fathers that drink come home and they beat their wives. And many are smoking and destroying their spiritual temple. Children today at the age of 10 and 16 already having sex. And they say that once you taste, you can never go back. Or once you taste, your life will never be the same again. If you look at this picture, this is the solution today. He brings in gossip. Eve listened to the lies of the devil. And he brought in what? She saw TV and she listened, or friends and company. He uses the environment to corrupt us. The world today is completely out of control. You do not have to be a Christian to realize that. The world is out of control. The great controversy still is going on. If you come with me, you analyze Genesis 3:6. It says that the woman saw, she took, she ate, but it also says that she not only kept it to herself, she gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. My dear friends, this was the devil's plan. His objective was not really to lead only Eve to eat it, but he was after her husband. Why was he after her husband? Come with me. I invite you now. Now remember, after they ate it, Eve took it, after she ate it, she took it and gave it to who? To her husband. And Adam also ate it. And after they ate it, they hid from God. And this happens to many people today. After they sin, instead of running back to God, the devil tells them that God will not forgive you. He tells them that you have gone too far. And so people hide from God. My dear friends, what makes church a church or a holy place? It is the presence of God. And in the Garden of Eden, they were hiding from the presence of God. And today, many people do not want to go to church. Some people, I've met people who say they believe they cannot be saved. They have gone too far. That is not true. God has a solution to your problems. I want us to read what Ellen White mentions in Last Day Events. And by the way, we are living in the last days. Chapter 6. Talking about television and theater. She says this. Among the most dangerous resorts for pleasure is the theater. Instead of being a school of morality and virtue, as is so often claimed, meaning people say that the theater is a school of morality and virtue, she says it is the very hotbed of immorality. Vicious habits and sinful propensities are strengthened and confirmed by these entertainments. Low songs, lewd gestures, expressions, and attitudes, what do? They deprave the imagination and debase the morals. Last Day Events, chapter 6. My dear friends, let us flee from these things. The devil seeks to destroy our homes. And because he cannot knock at your door and say, "Good morning, I am the devil. I have come here to corrupt your children. I have come here to destroy your marriage. I have come here to influence them to do evil things. I have come here to deprave their imagination and debase their morals." If he were to do that, you would not allow him in. You see, what he has done is he has gotten into our TV set, and what we do is we get him, and we put him in our living rooms or in our sitting rooms, and we put him in the center where everyone can see him, and we are entertained by the devil. Home controversy. Get rid of these entertainments. They will deprave your imagination. They will debase your morals. We have been chained by these things, and only Jesus Christ can set us free. The great controversy is real, and revival begins at home. Intruder's techniques. The Bible says that he went to Eve, and then Eve gave it to who? To her husband. The devil was not really after Eve. He was after Adam. Look at this. 1 Corinthians 15:22 says, in Adam all die. In Christ shall all be made alive. Look at this text very carefully. In Adam all die. Adam was not the first one to eat the fruit. It was Eve. This text says, in Adam all die. In Christ shall all be made alive. Meaning Adam brought the problem of sin and death. He allowed it to come in. But Jesus Christ has come to save us. And then you go to verse 45. The first man, Adam, was made a living soul. And the last Adam was made a quickening spirit. 1 Timothy 2:13. For Adam was first formed, then what? Then Eve. Intruder's technique, he used the Adam to humanity method. First, he was after Adam. And he got to Adam through Eve. He used Eve to get to Adam. Adam was the prince of the world. Remember, he was created first, and he was given authority over the earth. And the devil wanted to steal that authority from Adam, so he uses the Eve to Adam method. And after he got Adam, he used Eve to Adam, and Adam to humanity. Now come with me to Romans. Romans chapter 5, verse 14. The Bible talks about Adam's transgression. Why not Eve's transgression? She was the first one to eat it. John chapter 12, verse 31. The prince of this world, this is Jesus speaking, referring to the devil, and he calls him the prince of this world. And John 14, verse 30, again, this is Jesus speaking. He says, the prince of this world cometh and hath nothing in me. 16:11, again Jesus is speaking, and he says, the prince of this world is judged. And Ephesians 2:2, Paul says, the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. Adam was the prince of the world. But when Adam chose to sin, when Adam chose to disobey God, he lost that authority. He lost that position as the manager and prince of the world, and the devil became the prince of the world. That was what he was after. But he did not just come to Adam and tempt Adam first. He tempted Eve, and through Eve, he got Adam. And from Adam, he managed to reach down to humanity. The devil stole the world from Adam and became the prince of the earth. Eve to Adam method. This is very interesting. The first one was Adam. If you look there on the top, on your left, on the corner, the targets, you have there the targets, you have their positions, you have the method, and you have the reference for all of that. Let's look at the first target. Adam. What was his position? He was the prince of the world. The devil wanted to get him. What did he use? What method? Influence of his wife. Genesis 3:6. You go to the next person, next target, Adam. What was his position? He was the father of what? Of faith. Method, influence of his wife. God told him, I will multiply your seed, huh? And you must wait. His wife told him, sleep with my with the servant and have children with the servant. And because of that, you had two sons who ended up fighting. Ishmael had to leave and Isaac stayed. You go down to Lot. the nephew of Abraham, the nephew of the father of faith. Method, influence of wife. Spirit of prophecy mentions that his wife influenced him to go and live in Sodom and Gomorrah. And remember, Jesus says, remember Lot's wife, because when they were supposed to leave Sodom and Gomorrah, she looked back. So she wanted to stay there, and she was the one who influenced him also to live there. You have the next target, the fourth. Who is that? That is David. Position, a king after God's own heart. One of the best kings we've ever had. Method, influence of girlfriend, Delilah. 1 Samuel 11, verse 1 to 12. The next target, who is that? Solomon. Position, wisest person, that the wisest king that ever lived on earth apart from Jesus. Method, influence of girlfriends and wives. 1 Kings 11, chapter 11, verse 1 to 11, it says he loved many foreign women, meaning heathen women, unconverted women. The next one is Samson. Position, the strongest man that lived on earth apart from Jesus Christ. Influence, method. What was his method? Influence over, influence of girlfriend. Judges 16, verse 18. And then you have Herod, who was governor or politician. Influence of wife. You find this spirit of prophecy. Then you have who? Ahab. You also find that in the Bible. You have Ahab, who was also a king. He was an influential king. He was king of Israel. How did the devil corrupt him? Influence of his wife Jezebel. 1 Kings 21, 25. That verse says that King Ahab did more evil than all the kings before him because his wife stirred him for evil. There you have the method Eve to Adam, where the devil seeks to destroy the head of the home. And the way he does that is he uses influence. And he did that with these men. And unfortunately, they fell. But you know what? If you continue to read your Bible, we thank God for Joseph. What did Joseph do? Joseph ran away. We thank God for Joseph. It was not for Joseph, my dear friends, we would have a bad record. But we praise the Lord that Joseph ran away. My dear friends, come with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 16. It says, flee fornication. Run away. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body. But he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. Some of us, instead of running from sin, we are crawling away from sin. And we are even looking back, hoping that sin will catch up with us. Flee. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22 says, flee also youthful lusts, but follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace, with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Flee sexual immorality. As I said in the beginning, Jesus said, as it was in the days of Lot, so shall it be in these last days. So shall it be in the last days, or so shall it be before the coming of the Son of Man. My dear friends, we are living in these days. And let us flee from sin. Let us flee the sodomite. Now, restoration to Eve, of Eve to Adam method. Eve later on repented, and she influenced Adam to live a righteous life. Abigail is also an example of the restoration of Eve to Adam. Esther, Mary, Priscilla, and Eunice, these were all godly women who influenced people around her to live a godly life. And God is seeking to restore this method. Wives are to influence their husbands to live a righteous life and not to fall. Now the question is, why is this method so powerful? Adam fell through this. You have David, a man after God's own heart. You have who else? Solomon, the wisest. You have Samson, the strongest. Why? I'll take you back to this quotation we read, Patriots and Prophet, page 46, paragraph 1. Man was not made to dwell in solitude. Have you heard the saying that no man is an island? It says he was to be a social being. Listen to me. If you do not have the gift of celibacy, do not attempt to live alone. This is why you hear of priests that have become pedophiles, sleeping with children and even doing other things. Their religion forces them to live alone, to live in solitude, when God has not given them the gift of celibacy. Do not attempt to do so. Your life will be very miserable. She goes on to say, without companionship, the beautiful scenes and delightful employments of Eden would have failed to yield perfect happiness. When Adam was created in this beautiful garden, which was perfect, she says that she's talking about this was after Adam was created. Remember, he was created first. It says that without companionship, the beautiful scenes and delightful employments of Eden would have failed to yield perfect happiness. This means that if you don't have the gift of celibacy and you attempt to live alone without a partner, this is, I'm talking about a relationship of male and female, not male and male, you will not have happiness in your life. This means that same-sex marriage does not give, it is not fulfilling. It is not a fulfilling marriage. She goes on to say, even communion with angels could not have satisfied his desire for sympathy and companionship. There was none of the same nature to love and to be loved. Judges chapter 7 verse 2 says, and the Lord God said unto Gideon, the people that are with thee are what? Too many for me to give the Midianites into their hands, lest Israel vaunt themselves against me, saying, mine own hand hath saved me. In this verse, well, in this story, God was using Israel to destroy what? The Midianites. And God told them, do not bring so many people. I want few people. Do not bring too many people. If I use a lot of people, you will boast. You guys will boast and you will say that we have defeated them because we are strong, because we are many. So God says, bring me only few people and I will show you that I don't need a whole army. And if you go to verse 4, the Bible says, and the Lord said unto Gideon, the people are yet too what? The people are yet too many. Bring them down unto the water and I will try them for thee there. My dear friends, a home with God is the majority. Do not look around you. Do not try to imitate other homes. Even if you're the only home having worship in the morning, if you're the only home going for midweek, going for Vespers, going early to church, dressing modestly, having devotionals, reading your Bible, even if you're the only home in your barangay or in your city, praying and fasting, do not give up. A home with God is the majority. God does not need an army to defeat the forces of darkness. One home plus God equals an army. One man with God is the majority. All we need is to be faithful. All we need is to give ourselves wholly to the Lord. The home controversy is real, and God is the solution. As we close, I want to draw your attention to John 1:26. The Bible's talking about Jesus says that Jesus is the Lamb which taketh away the sins of the world. This was John who said, he said, behold, the Lamb of God which taketh away the sin of the world. He said this when he saw Jesus passing and he was standing with his disciple. Hebrews 9:26 says, for then must he, Jesus, often have suffered since the foundation of the what? The foundation of the world. But now once in the end of the world hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. In the beginning, we have discovered that the Garden of Eden was a home. And when the devil intruded and introduced self, the home controversy began. And unfortunately, he defiled the home. But on that day, a lamb was slain that pointed to Jesus Christ. That Jesus, as in Hebrews 9:26 says, For then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world, but now in the end of the world hath appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Yes, in the beginning, sin entered the home. It defiled the home. It was no longer perfect. Now there was strife in the home. There's division in the home. But Jesus Christ is the Lamb of God who came to take away sin from the world. And it is only through Jesus Christ. This means that only Jesus can restore peace in a home. A home without Jesus is not a peaceful home. My dear friends, in Genesis 1 and 2, you have the world as God created it. You have the perfect home. You have Eden, earth, as the perfect home. Unfortunately, the intruder came and introduced self. And he caused a division between man and God. In the beginning, we were with God. Sin separated us from God. Jesus Christ has come to restore us. He has come to reunite us. He has come to connect us back to God. He came and he lived. He did live in this world, both human, being both human and God at the same time. I cannot explain that to you. It is a mystery. But Jesus Christ came in the flesh. And he lived in this world, but he did not sin. He lived a perfect life, a blameless life. And he offered his life for us. And he resurrected. Jesus came to restore the home that was broken by the devil. Jesus came to take back that authority that the devil stole from Adam. He came to take it back. He came to buy back the land. He came to restore home. He came to restore Eden. And as I said, in Genesis 1 and 2, you have Eden, the perfect home, the world as God intended it. From Genesis 3 to Revelations 20, you have the great controversy. In Genesis 1 and 2, you have male and female. From Genesis 3 to Revelations 20, you have the male and male. For example, Leviticus 18 verse 22 says that a male must not sleep with another male as he sleeps with a woman. Deuteronomy 22 verse 5 says that a woman must not wear anything that pertaineth to a man, nor should a man wear anything that pertaineth to a man. You have the story of Sodom and Gomorrah in between, where people had legalized same-sex marriage in Sodom and Gomorrah. You have war in between the Bible. You have calamity. You have destruction. But even in between that calamity, God is always there pleading with his people. And his people suffer because they disobey him. They suffer because they put God aside. They suffer because they put God's law aside. And in these last days, God seeks to draw us back to his word. God is drawing us back to heaven. Genesis 1 and 2, I repeat, you have the world as God intended it. From Genesis 3 to Revelations 20, you have the great controversy. But Revelations 21 and 22, you have Eden restored. You have the world restored as God wants it. You have the perfect home in Genesis 1 and 2. In between, you have corruption. The home is distorted. But thank God for Jesus Christ, who came to die, resurrected, defeated sin and the devil, and he is going to restore Eden. You find that in Revelations 21 and 22. My dear friends, this means that the great controversy is the plan of salvation is home restoration. God is seeking to restore Eden. God is seeking to restore us back to the original. And God has a question for you. Can I help you build a home? Can I help you build a home? God will never force himself into our lives. He will never force himself into our home. We must accept. And Jesus is the only solution. And as we draw to the end of this world will be destroyed as Sodom and Gomorrah was destroyed and as the world was destroyed with the flood because of its iniquity. But before God destroys this world, God is going to seal his faithful servants. He's going to seal those that have held on. And by the way, do not fear persecution. Do not fear anything that the devil can bring to you. He is defeated already. When persecution comes, God will give you enough strength to bear it. God will not leave you alone. God will be with us until the end. As you see false teachings, as you see division coming, and even in the church, do not fear. Jesus Christ is in control. He is always on time, and Jesus is a promise keeper. Let them legalize same-sex marriage. Let them do what they want to do. Let us not focus too much on these things, but let us focus on our relationship with Christ. The question is, are you reading your Bibles? The question is, are you praying? Are you fasting? Are you seeking to have a relationship with God? The devil is really seeking to destroy, to cause a division between us and God. That's what he did in the Garden of Eden. Before, they used to commune with God, but after sin, they ran away from God. There was a division there. There was a barrier. Sin came in, and Jesus is that solution. Jesus is the real pontiff. And by the way, pontiff means the bridge maker. The real pontiff is Jesus Christ. There's a man going around calling himself the pontiff. The real pontiff is Jesus. Only Jesus can restore us to the Father. Jesus is that only bridge to God. Will you allow Jesus Christ to reconnect you? Will you allow you Jesus Christ to restore you back to God? The plan of salvation is home restoration. And only Jesus can restore us back to God. If this is your desire, I want to invite you to bow your heads with me. I want to invite you, wherever you are, to bow your heads. Jesus is able to restore us. Jesus is able to forgive us. In fact, Hebrews 7:25 says that he's able to save even to the uttermost, the vilest, no matter how far you have gone. If you truly repent, if you recognize that you have sinned, we are the ones to blame for this. We are the ones who departed from God's law. We allowed ourselves to be entertained by the devil. My dear friends, it is time for us to get back to God. It is time for us to restore that relationship with God. Jesus is coming soon. Very, very soon. Luke 17, Jesus says, as it was in the days of Lot, so shall it be. My dear friends, we are living in the days of Lot. Jesus is coming. Some have stopped praying. They no longer pray as they used to pray. Some don't fast anymore. Some do not read the Bible anymore. Some have stopped going to church. My dear friends, it is time, for our salvation is nearer than when we first believe. Let us pray. Father in heaven, thank you for speaking to us. Thank you for being faithful once again. We give you glory and we praise you for your initiative. Thank you for everything. I pray, Father, for those that are listening to this message. Many of them are in need of being restored. And I myself come to you every day seeking a restoration. Father in heaven, set us free from self. Fill us with your spirit. And Lord, we also pray for the church as we go through this storm. Father, we know that you are going to lead this church. We know that you are going to be there and you will not allow your ship to sink. I simply intercede for those souls that are contemplating to leave this home, for those souls that are contemplating to leave this boat, for those souls that are contemplating to leave the church. I pray in Jesus' name that you may convict them and that you may encourage them to remain in this boat, because we will get home soon. Even if it looks like it's going to fall, like it's going to sink, but because Jesus is that captain, it will never sink. And we are going to reach home. Father, thank you so much. May you continue to bless us spiritually. And may this message strengthen us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.